So the microservices has been a key buzzword over the last couple of years. And in securing microservices, there has been like a lot of new challenges. And then there are new trends that becoming emerging that to solve those challenges. And so before going into those details, so let's start from the beginning. So what is microservice architecture is about? So it's about developing a single application as a collection of small independent services. So the key criteria are like those are running in their own process and developed and deployed independently. So microservices usually provide focused, scoped, modular approach for the application design. And so it's driven by the key primary goal where one should be able to do a change, test it, and deploy it immediately into the production. So the speed to the production. So if you look at how the all monolithic applications are developed, so if we consider the characteristics of these applications, so all these services, the services that are used by the monolithic applications are deployed in the same runtime, and the so the application server that hosting these services usually provides some session management capabilities, and that those different services also have access to the those session management capabilities provided by the application servers. So service to service interactions are usually local, and so the authentication for these monolithic applications done at a interceptor level, where like so all the requests come to the application, intercept at the some interceptor. If we think about the Java EV world, so the serverless filter, so intercepting all the incoming messages and checking for access in session. If not, get the user authenticated and establishing a session. So if we summarize the application level security for the monolithic application, so there are two major things. So the authenticating the end user. So authenticating end user consists of talking to its own user repositories. There can be like multiple heterogeneous user repositories like LDAP, AD, Active Directory, database based user repositories, and so the identity and access management solutions has to deal with integrating all these multiple user repositories and get the user authenticated. And if the users are with from a different trust domain to the application, that can be so it has to interact with some external IDPs, like so the partner IDPs, identity providers, or the social identity providers, that depending on the application nature. So the usual identity and access management system that is catering the traditional application level security provides these kind of features for the user authentication. And of course, as Ishar also mentioned, there are multi-factor and adaptive capabilities are also supported with these identity providers. And the other aspect is the authorization. So if the this application wants to decouple the authorization policies from its key business logic, those policies are usually offloaded to a central access management system, where the policy management parties like policy administrators can change those policies in a dynamic way without changing the core services. So these are so the those policy administration happens in a central access management system, and the policy evolution also happen so in a central manner, like so when request comes to a monolithic application, it generates some authorization request and invoke the access management system and evaluate its policies and get back with the authorization decision. So this is the traditional application level security. So key criteria are like in a monolithic application, there are shared user session and the interactions happen in a same runtime locally. And in a microservice as well, each microservices are deployed and served independently, and there are no central governing party to establishing the authentication or enforcing authorization. So the nature of the independent microservices, since the microservices are independent to each other, so each microservice now has to enforce their authentication and authorization capabilities. And since there are like several microservices are deploying for the providing the same application capability, so number of microservices getting high, the broader the attack surface getting also. And so we cannot directly apply the same authentication and authorization techniques that we use to develop the older monolithic applications. So because like, so we cannot directly, in a microservice level, we cannot directly access the user repositories and get the end user authenticated. Because like the microservices are usually stateless, immutable manner. So they need to be in that if they are to authenticate user in each request, so there will be a lot of load for the user repositories as well as that doesn't scale and causing for the performance issues. And due to the nature of microservice deployment, so there are complexities over the deployment aspect as well. And any solution that come up with for the this microservice security has to be independent of from the technology that technology or the language that microservices are developed of, because like so different microservices can be deployed in their own languages, own technology stack. So there has to be polyglot architecture for the solution. So if we simplify the common problem, so the key criteria is the secured microservices are need to be accessed by different independent clients. And along with that, it has to authenticate on behalf of the end user and do operations on behalf of the end user. So this is the general problem that need to be solved in a microservice security. So so the solution is to have the access delegation capability. So the access delegation so the OAuth2 protocol provides like a widely adapted protocol for the access delegation. So let's see how the OAuth2 solves the microservice security problem. So so as we see here, like so the client now authenticating the end user over the authorization server, not in the microservice level. So the authentication happens, so the client now send a authorized request to the authorization server, and authorization server is the one So it's requesting the resource owner to authenticate himself against the authorization server and proceed with the authorization, whether this this client is requesting acceptable resources of the resource owner. So once the resource owner provide the authorization, authorization server is generating an access token and then send back to the client. And now the client access the auth resource server, in our case a microservice, along with the access token. And then so the in the microservice level, what it gets is a opaque access token. It doesn't have any value or like a value that can be interpreted the user any details. So it has to talk to the authorization server and validate that access token, whether it's a valid or access token, and get back the user details. So in this approach, the microservice offloading its end-use authentication to a authorization server, but there is still downside of this approach. Each request to the microservice now comes with an access token, opaque access token, and that has to be validated against the authorization server. So for each request comes to the microservice, now has to invoke the authorization server. So it can be solved this problem by using the self-contained access tokens. So the first half of the flow is the same as the previous one. So the client is generating authorization request to the authorization server, and then resource owner authenticate against the authorization server and provide the authorization to the requested scopes. And now, instead of generating an opaque random access token, authorization now, what it do is like generating a JWT, which including the user details, and usually it's signed and hand over to the client. So now the client have an do the protected resource request. So as to, similar to the previous one, so now the microservice or the protected resource can validate the JWT, whether it's a trusted one, whether it's issued by the authorization server itself, and if it is valid, then it can extract the user detail without calling the authorization server. So in this manner, there are no additional requests that need to be done by the microservice to the authorization server. So we discussed about the key problem in the microservice security and solution for that. But the story is not simple as that. So the there are multiple aspects of the microservice security. So the first one is the secure development. So where so the developer who change or do any change to the service implementation has to be, so once developer do any change to the its service implementation, it's pushed to some source repository. So and in the secure development, once the developer pushed his code change to the source repository, so it's triggering a static and dynamic code scans. So and based on that, so it can, so if it is the whole process is part integrated as a part of CI/CD process, user developer immediately get notified whether if there are any vulnerabilities introduced by this code change by running the static and dynamic code analysis. So so the key idea is, so any issue or any risks that can be injected during the development time get notified immediately to the development team. So this aligns with the key driving force behind the microservice speed to the production, because like you don't want to wait until the last moment to do the security scanning or let the production system to be test on those vulnerabilities. So this aspect, the secure development aspect, is mostly same as the is used to be developed at the microservice as well. Monolithic applications as well. The later two aspects are the one that having significant difference from the monolithic application. So the second aspect is the secure deployment. So in the microservice world, so that there can be thousands of hundreds of different services that we need to be deployed or for a given deployment. So the key rule is to have a service per host. That service per host it provides isolation level that host different service need to be. So in the host, it doesn't necessary to be a physical instance. It can be a container as well. So the each service has its isolated environment. So the it doesn't get intercepted by the malfunctioning of the other services. So, but here we are relying much on the container level security. We trust different containers does not breach their boundaries. So here the container fine tuning of the correct level container level security is needed. So secure deployment doesn't have much impact on the for a IAM system. So it's mostly for the application level security. So in the application level security, so there are two aspects. So edge security and the service-to-service security. In the edge security, is the one it's need to enforce or have a focused enforcement on the authenticating the end user or the authorization against the common set of policies. So, in the service-to-service security, it's mostly focused on the how to share the user context among the different microservices, and then again, so the edge security, it's authorizing user against the common set of policies that is applicable for all the microservices. In the service-to-service security, authorization is about applying the service-specific authorization policies. So let's see how edge security has been done. So it's usually done with the API gateway pattern. So where publicly exposed microservices are exposed to the external network through an API gateway. So the these API gateway are the one validating the end user authentication and, if needed, enforcing the common set of policies. If we go through with like a end-to-end flow, like so similar to the our early example, so the user authenticates against the authorization server, and client gets an access token, and this is usually an opaque access token because this will be used outside the network, and this access token, so the client invoke APIs that are exposed through the API gateway using the opaque access token, and the gateway now exchange that opaque access token to a JWT and relay that JWT to downstream microservices, and now microservices can validate those JWT, whether those are issued by the key manager or the authorization server that they are trust, and use the user information embedded in the, those JWT. So let's talk about the service to service security aspects. So in a monolithic applications, so the TLS mutual authentication is the mostly adapted server to server authentication mechanism. But TLS mutual authentication itself have set of problems that are not key blockers for the monolithic applications, like so how to deal with certificate revocation, key rotation, and how to do the initial certificate provisioning or building the initial trust. So so there has been a set of trends that Netflix has been came up with, like so in order to overcome the certificate revocation and key rotation aspects of the mutual authentication, using a short-lived certification. So so the certificates are now, so the usual certificates we use to do the TLS authentication are having kind of long durations, like can be 1 year, 2 year, 10 years, like that. But in this microservice level communication, so it's need to use a shorter level, very like 5 minutes or 1 minute or 30 minutes, depends on the requirement. So Netflix come up with approach where to overcome the certificate revocation and rotation problem using the short-lived certificates. Still, using the short-lived certificates means like you have to you will be generating new certificates in a very frequent manner, so that becomes the certificate provisioning and the initial trust bootstrapping make much more serious. So SPIFFI, SPIFFI is a specification that tries to solve the initial trust bootstrapping. SPIFFI stands for Secure Production Identity Framework for Everyone. So what SPIFFI does is SPIFFI provides an identifier for each services. So in the SPIFFI specification, it's talked as a workload. So so the SPIFFI ID looks like a URL. So the host name would be a trust domain that workload is resides on, or the services is deployed on. And the context and the resource paths are identifying the actual services. So there are a couple of implementation of SPIFFI, like Spire and the Istio. So basically, so there are a lot of information about SPIFFI, like and so the how SPIFFI works, and so we don't go on those details, but we are just talking about in high level, like so the SPIFFI, what it does is like it's initially establishing its trust based on the agent that is deployed on the same service or the same host in where the service is hosted on. So basically, at the initial level, so workload or the service call its agent and requires for a short-lived certificate, or it's called a SPIFFI verified identity documents. So and there is a central SPIFFI server that is generating these. It's like a CA, certificate authority, that generating the signing these SPIFFI verified identity documents, and those once the source workload or the source service retrieve those SVIDs, it's called its trust, its destination workload or the destination service, and destination service, again, call it Spiffy agent. So, and Spiffy agent calls the Spiffy server and verify the Spiffy IDs. And if those are verified, it's accept that. So these certificates are provided in the origin request are depend is actually owned by the original workload and provisioning the initial certificate trust bootstrapping problem. So so this is high level diagram like where how the Spiffy generating its original Spiffy IDs. So I'm not going to go into details on this. So this is somewhat promising trend that is happening around the this trust bootstrapping problem. So so there are two major implementations on that as well. So then in the service-to-service security, it's need to have a common data container to pass the user information, user entitlement, and so that containers should be able to transfer those details across the like unsecured channel. So the JWT is the very good candidate on that. So and the, almost all the implementation of the so the widely adopted soft microservice architecture models using the JWT as the container that transport the data among the different services. So so with this Spiffy we have like a proper established in we have the certificates already in place among the source workload and the destination workload, and so that makes the source and destination workloads trusting each other, and so with the JWT we can sign the JWT and send that JWT to the source workload to the destination workload or the source microservice to destination microservice. And basically, destination microservice can validate that JWT and get the user details. So this is a sample of JWT, and JWT has two different implementation. So JWS and JWE, JSON Web Signature and JSON Web Encryption. So so. So we talked about the application level security, how to do the user authentication, and then we talked about the service to service security and how to build the initial trust problem and how to transfer the data in a secure manner, and then we are moving to the access control like. So evaluating the different access control policies in a independent microservice. So Eclipse Foundation has came up with the specification called microprofile JWT. So this is not only about the authorization or the access control. So what it does is it introduces two new claims to the JWT user principle and user groups. Using these user groups, like now the JWT contains the user entitlements, and so it can do the role-based access controls based on those entitlements. And the policy evaluation. So this is the traditional way of policy evaluation. If you model that the same concept to the microservices, but this is has its own limitations. Like so, each microservice has to call the external PDP, and that PDP might not have all the information that need to be evaluate the policy need to be called back to the microservices to get those information and so forth. So central PDP approach is not widely recommended, and having an embedded PDP is the common approach that can be used for the microservices. So where these PDPs are subscribed to the set of policies that is deployed by the central policy administration point. So open policy agent is another specification comes with the for the embedded policy evaluation. So as you can see there is a with the service it's have an OPA or open policy agent that is running the in the same can be run as a sidecar or a daemon or a library. So this also has a couple of implementations, so it's Stew and the linker. So the deployment models, so the Docker allows to run services on a same host machine as a so multiple services to run in the same host in as a inside the different containers. So Kubernetes abstract away the hardware infrastructure and expose the whole deployment as a single computational entity. And with the Kubernetes, we had the concept called pods, where pod can multiple containers can be run on the same pod, which leads to an interesting concept called sidecar. So with respect to security, security sidecar is another container running on the same pod where the microservice is running on. So which offloading the implementation to do the invoking the external microservice or the introspection, that means like validating the JWT or the OPAC key you received it, and tokens means token introspection, like if you wanted to rewrap the JWT that you received to call it some external endpoint, you need to generate a token from yourself. So or the PDP that we discussed earlier, like the OPA, so calling as agent that is resides in the security sidecar. And if the microservice need to get the additional user information, which are not present in the original JWT, the sidecar also help you on that as well. So we quickly ran through all the multiple concepts on the microservice security. So the microservice paradigm introduced a whole lot of new challenges to the enforced security, and there are multiple trends emerging with the application security and the deployment security aspects. So with regards to an IAM, so the so API driven strong access delegation capabilities is a key criteria to be microservice friendly IAM.